What can you buy with $2.5 billion in the mid-1980s? Eggs, for the most part, are the traditional, historical measurement of inflation. And back then, they cost roughly $1.01 for a dozen. So roughly 30 billion eggs. But Rupert Murdoch only bought 7 things. They just all happened to be television stations from Metro Media, which gave birth to the Fox Network back in 1985. Barry Diller had left Paramount a year earlier to become chairman of Fox, and now he had a new toy at his disposal. Diller would help build the fourth network into a competitor. But the LA Times was critical of Diller's process. Quote, "He is widely regarded as a man of great personal sophistication and taste, but as the architect of Fox TV, he was ultimately the pragmatic bottom liner in his programming. Part of the original programming for Fox was Sufficient Evidence, The New Adventures of Beans Baxter, a show about a kid spy, Women in Prison, a show about women in prison with a theme song imitating Tom Jones. One of the first programs on the network to rise above the fray was the Tracey Ullman Show, and it would give Paul Germain his next opportunity."
So it's 85, and Brooks decides he's going to go back into television with the Tracey Ullman Show. He'd met this young British comedian. He thought she did some really wonderful work, and he thought, I'm going to build a show around her. And I remember there was a big meeting in his office. He had this big office on the Fox lot. I think it was originally built for Frank Sinatra or something. It looks like this nice house, right? The room was sunken beneath the level of the rest of the building. So you take these two or three steps down to get into his office. And I was sitting on those steps, and there was this big meeting, and everybody and he was talking about what he wanted to do with the show. And people were taking notes, and I was the kid sitting in the corner. He's talking about what he wants to do for the Tracey Ullman Show. And he says, I think that the show should have these sketches, but I want them to be more than sketches. They're like little sitcom stories. Tracey will be in different ones each week, but we'll bring some back if we're liking them, if they're working. And they'll be more elaborate, almost like little sitcoms, right? These will be like 6-7 minutes long. They won't be just little sketches. They'll be really elaborate little stories. Between them, I was thinking we'd do animated interstitials. You know, maybe 30-second little animated pieces. And somebody says, okay, that's great. So who do you want to get to do that? But what will the animation be? What is it? Brooks looked around his room. Well, someone had given him an original poster board from one of Matt Groening's cartoons. He had it framed and it was on his wall. So he's looking around his office and he said, let's get that guy. So I'm 25 years old, 26, something like that. And I jump up with youthful enthusiasm and I said, oh, that's a great idea. I love that guy's work. Because I'd read them in the old LA Reader. They were really hip at the time. And I thought, that's great. You should do that though. That's an excellent idea. And Brooks looked at me and said, great, go do it. And I said, what? He said, go do it. We need about 30 seconds of animation a week. And so, you know, we need to get that priced out and produced. Go ahead and make it. And I said, but I don't know anything about animation. And he said, well, you better learn.
Life in Hell started its lengthy run in 1978 with Wet Magazine. A few years later, it began to appear in papers nationwide. Its main character was Binky the Rabbit, with long ears and the look of a Simpson. The particular comic strip that had the honor of hanging on Brooks's wall was The Los Angeles Way of Death, which depicts the ways people die in Los Angeles, including cop, failure, and success. The framed strip was given to Brooks by Polly Platt, the production designer on Terms of Endearment. And so with that bit of serendipity, Groening was brought in to pitch Life in Hell. But he was weary that the studio would ruin it and take his copyright, so he pitched The Simpsons based on his own family. Brooks approved and slated it for one-minute bumpers in the Tracey Ullman Show. And Paul was put in charge of making sure the one-minute shorts happened.
So I got tossed into doing this. So I cut out one of the cartoons from the newspaper and Xeroxed it a bunch of times. I knew that they were going to want really good animation, and I knew they weren't going to want the usual suspects like Disney or Warner Brothers or Hanna-Barbera. Something more interesting, something unique. I looked up animation in the old LA 411 guide. I mean, this is pre-internet. You had this book that had industry services, and I looked up animation in the book, and there were, 30 different vendors offering animation services. So I called every single one of them, and I said, I'm from this company. We're going to be doing this. If they were interested, I'd say, okay, I'm going to send you this cartoon. Please send me back your reel and give me a bid for doing 2 minutes of this a week. Within a couple of weeks, I had a big packing box full of VHS tapes of reels of all these companies with their bids rubber banded around them. And I thought, what am I going to do with this? I don't know how to do this. Finally, they hired an associate producer for the show, a guy named Jeffrey Townsend, who's a really great guy, still a friend of mine, a little older than I, a little more experienced than I. And he came in and he said, okay, tell me what's going on with this animation thing. What are you doing? I said, well, I've got all these reels. And he said, have you looked at them? And I said, yeah, I've watched them all. And he said, what do you think? And I said, oh, most of them are terrible. Jolly Green Giant commercials and Smurfs and all this awful 70s, you know, and early 80s animation, just awful stuff. And I said, but there's this one company that has kind of an interesting reel. And he said, show it to me. So the reel was from Klasky Chupo, which I didn't know anything about them. They said, funny name, you know. What was on the reel were these really cool cartoons. It turned out those were all the student films from the guys he had hired, but they were really cool. They were all this CalArts cool animation stuff, you know, guys like Wes Archer and David Silverman, who would go on to become the guys who did The Simpsons. Anyway, I showed it to him and he goes, yeah, this stuff's really great. What was his bid like? And I said, they had a really good bid. It was a very good price. And he said, let's go meet him. So we went over there and met them. At the time, it was Gabor Chupo and his wife, Arlene Klasky. They had this little business on Seward Street. Gabor was a smart guy. He was this Eastern European immigrant. He was ambitious and he wanted to do something bigger. He didn't want to spend his life doing these little commercials and little spinning logos. He wanted to get into character animation. He got this call from me and he saw this as a big opportunity. He took it really seriously. He gave us a really good bid. You know, when we met with him, he was really enthusiastic and we decided to go with him. We decided to hire him. So in a sense, I hired them.
Jeffrey Townsend.
Paul had kind of been tasked with the research, and then he sort of shared his research with me. And he did so very cleverly because he allowed me to feel like I'd had a role, but honestly, I had no role. He already liked Klasky Chupo. And I think that what happened was I had a different reason for liking Klasky Chupo as the choice. I think he genuinely liked what he saw on the reel, which was actually not true for me. But when I met them, I saw the right kind of desperation. I thought, oh my gosh, if we can just be bringing these little stupid short cartoons to this facility, it'll be all hands on deck. We will be the only job that they are actually paying attention to, and we will have their undivided attention. And I love that. That was my private reason for saying yes. Maybe that's a revealing story about him and me. I was more interested in what is this working relationship like in 8 months, week after week after week of impossible changes and deadlines and craziness. How soon before the animation house that we pick is sick of us and wants to get out of the contract? And I thought that they had a kind of hungry resilience that would serve us well and serve them well. I mean, it's that old thing of, is there a win-win here? And I felt like there was with them. I don't know how that makes me sound, but normally I'm a right hemisphere guy, but this is a moment of kind of, I guess, going after right hemisphere relationship instead of right hemisphere art. The truer truth is that I trusted Paul's judgment in some foundational way, and I wanted to honor that. That's the third win. If it's a win-win-win, I wanted it to be Paul's choice on some level. But I was also really liking how threadbare the studio was. Isn't that horrible?
Paul would be working under somewhat of a guru, or at the very least, a son of a guru. Jeffrey's father was famed executive Robert Townsend, who wrote Up the Organization, How to Stop the Corporation from Stifling People and Strangling Profits, which contains gems like eliminate company parking spots. Because if you're the most important person at work, you'll be there the earliest anyway.
I want to say that it was during the production of After Hours, a movie I designed for Scorsese. I was invited to be a resource at the June Lab of the Sundance Institute. I remember arriving for that, and they were having a kind of goodbye party for people that were leaving that had been there. And Jim Brooks was one of the people that had been there. He was still kind of a mystery to me. You know, I knew him as a TV guy, and then suddenly now this feature guy. And I liked that he was exploring in terms of endearment that pathos mixed with comedy, that movie that is basically a tearjerker and there's lots of good dialogue. So I made my way across the room and just sort of did, you know, the most tolerable version I could of, hey, I just wanted to express my appreciation for your movie. And he did that really polite thing of turning it around and making it about me. I mean, if it was 5 minutes, that might even be exaggerating. This little conversation at Sundance. And so I guess it's 3 years later that he's putting together the Tracey Ullman Show, and he has someone track me down. The initial ask was whether I wanted to design the show, and I was kind of itchy for something different, but it wasn't to start designing TV. And so I took the meeting because they had sent me all this stuff about Tracey Ullman. They'd sent me, oh, I don't know, VHS tapes of her British TV show. They'd sent me some scripts that they'd been working on. And I thought the whole thing was stunning. So I said, well, I don't want to be your designer, but I want to get on your roster of directors. So they sort of chewed on that for a minute, and they came back with, will you be the associate producer on the show? I was still kind of wowed by the enormity of what I saw as Jim Brooks's talent, and that they were asking me to do something really different. I didn't know exactly what I was getting into, but I said yes. It just sounded the exact right kind of different. It was also going to be a journey of Jeffrey learning how to say no, which I didn't really learn at that point. And so they were throwing me as much as they felt like I could handle. And so I ended up basically being in charge of the live audience's experience, as well as being in charge of post, which is kind of, it's sort of being the Jared Kushner of the Tracey Ullman Show. You just have way too many things that you've been assigned. But I was having fun. One of the things that landed on my plate as the lowest ranking producer was, oh, and by the way, you have to handle the animation. And my reaction was kind of like, the what? And it's like, oh, we're going to have these little bumpers, these little short cartoons before and after each commercial break. And we've made deals with two cartoonists, Matt Groening and M.K. Brown. You're in charge of getting those cartoons made. And I was like, what? And I was aghast at the whole idea that there was this one more thing, and it was a very large one more thing. Along with the kind of, here's the thing you have to do, was the message, oh, but you can choose a production assistant from the pool of production assistants to work with you on that. I thought, well, I'd be an idiot not to say yes to that. And I said, can I pick whoever I want? And they said, absolutely. And I said, then I pick Paul Germain. And there was this initial sort of like, well, why Paul? And I said, because he's smart and he understands story and he's good company at lunch. And why are you asking why I'm picking Paul? So I hope Paul will forgive me for this, but here's what I thought it was about at the time. There was a kind of competitive spirit in the production assistant pool for being cool, just like terrific haircuts. There was a lot of attention paid to clothing. Everybody wanted to be like the coolest PA. But there was somebody who just wasn't even playing and just could not seem to even like pay attention. And that was Paul. And I completely adored that about him. His attention is on the right things. If we're talking about, like, why would somebody have any attitude at all about why did I pick Paul, it was just purely that. For people who weren't looking deeply, you know, I mean, Paul is, maybe he'll be okay with me saying this. I think he must have looked 45 when he was newborn. I've never known anybody quite like Paul in terms of affect that you know has been with him since he was in elementary school. Literally, from the first time we ever wandered into the commissary and decided to sit at the same table and have lunch, I held Paul in a very kind of high esteem. Paul was already kind of like a sage to me. I mean, yes, we had roles on the Tracey Ullman Show where I knew I was his boss, but once we would be talking about stuff, I would say, no, this guy has juice. This guy has wisdom. This guy, he's cracked part of the story puzzle that I haven't cracked yet. And I love that about him. That was the beginning of a really fun working relationship that until this time had only really been a handful of lunches. So here's one of my favorite parts of this journey. I had what had mostly been at that point a telephone relationship with Matt Groening, who I found to be just one of the most adorable humans in terms of his spirit and his sense of humor and how nice he was and how funny he was, just sort of like a national treasure. But I had this awful task of, I need to get these scripts out of him, some kind of commitment as to what on earth these cartoons are. So I would call him, I kind of ramped it up to about every week, and he would just get all nervous and flustered and say, yeah, they're coming along. They're pretty good. They're coming along. But I don't think he's very he's a very good liar. And it seemed kind of plain to me that they weren't coming along, and he had nothing. And so I did something really desperate and without a lot of forethought. I called him up on one of my sort of weekly calls, and I said, "Hey, Matt, it's Jeffrey. You know, I'm not calling about the scripts." And he was like, "Oh, you're not?" And I said, "No, this is something else, but we should probably do it in person. Is there any way you can come by, like, maybe 3 o'clock today or 3:30, what works for you?" And we found a time. And of course, I was completely lying. And he showed up, brought him into my office and sat him on the couch. And I closed the door to my office and I said, "Okay, I'm sorry, I lied. It's all about the script. All I know how to do is hand you a stack of copier paper and a Sharpie. And I'm not going to let you go until you've drawn some characters and the beginning of some sample dialogue. You know, forget the script. Give me the world of what we're doing here, because I have to cast voices." You know, we found this tiny little animation house called Klasky Chupo. And, you know, we like them and they like us. And we think that, you know, they will bend over backwards to do this right. But we need a place to begin. And so he sat and began to doodle his family. I'm tickled to say that I have all but one of these drawings still. Someone, when I had them up on my bulletin board there at the office, someone stole the Bart drawing. But they're unusual. They're unmistakably Matt. They're his style. But Homer hadn't really been found yet. Homer was basically tall Bart in a suit with the same kind of sawtooth buzz cut. But they're these adorable drawings, and that's all I had for what seemed like an eternity, with these little scraps of paper with characters and maybe 4 or 5 dialogue balloons. I was working with a casting director named Bonnie Pietola, and she began sending me the audio cassettes of voiceover talent. I immediately kind of pushed back a little bit. I said, you know, I know that there's this tradition, this grand tradition of women doing kid voices, and I get it. I said, but the thing about Bart is I think it would be terrible if it ever sounded like someone trying to sound young. What we really need is the way that a kid tries to sound older than he is. Bonnie was very polite, but didn't really, you know how to respond to this really abstract thing that I was saying. But one day in the stack of cassettes, there was one voice in a whole series of voices by a voice artist named Nancy Cartwright. And there was this one moment where she did a voice that we all now know as the Bart voice, but it sounded like a kid whose voice has not changed, trying really hard to make it sound like his voice is changing, where she forced her voice in this wonderfully awkward place, trying to make it sound lower. I asked for her to come in. I had seen Yardley Smith on Broadway in The Real Thing and remember her really distinctive voice from that show. I actually thought it was a voice she was putting on for the whole show. And then I realized it's pretty close to her real voice, at least at that age. And as we were bringing the actors in to read with Matt and I, the people outside were just randomly pairing them. They were pairing Lisa's and Bart's. So we were getting our kind of like regular pairs of women who do kid voices for animation. And I was kind of, you know, not really feeling it. And we had so little dialogue from these little drawings with the dialogue balloons. We had so little to go from that we had started asking the actors if they wouldn't mind to improvise a little sibling argument. And mostly those were also very lackluster and uninspiring. And then, as fate would have it, Nancy Cartwright and Yardley Smith were paired up in the lobby and sent in together. And I briefly asked Nancy if she knew which voice I was referring to when I described this sort of forced, like a kid making his voice sound deeper. She knew exactly the one I meant. I said, "Do you mind? Is that painful or anything? Do you mind doing that for this?" She said, no, it's fine." And so they just read these 5 little lines of dialogue that we had, and then we did our standard question about, would you guys mind improvising a little argument? And this thing escalated so fast and got so funny so quickly. People were actually concerned in the neighboring offices. They just couldn't figure out what was happening in there. Obviously, I did not do a lot of casting out of there because of what my job was. It was just they were shrieking at each other, but it was funny. It wasn't like out of control. It wasn't like bad improv. It was just hysterically funny. And so I believe in the moment we didn't spill the beans to Nancy and Yardley on the spot, but thanked them and said goodbye. And Matt and I looked at each other and said, oh my gosh, could it be that easy? I mean, that's them. And what had already happened kind of out of Matt's view was I had been told that I needed to try to cast from the cast of the show, the Tracey Ullman Show, for the voices for these cartoons, because that meant that they were free. They were already on the show's payroll. And so I had worked a little bit over the phone with Julie Kavner. She allowed me to use the word gravel for that texture thing that she can do. I would just sort of gently say, do you mind like a little more gravel? Can we, do you mind just like a little more texture? Could you, you know, pushing on that. And then I found out we had hired a guy that wasn't in LA yet. He hadn't arrived yet. He was still in Chicago and his name was Dan Castellaneta. So I'm introducing myself over the phone as like some low rent bottom of the totem pole producer who's trying to talk him into a cartoon voice, but he hasn't even shown up and worked with us yet. But I discovered that he's a mimic of celebrities, and especially that sort of old school, like old Hollywood voices that you can tell he used to do for his parents. And so we were quickly talking over the phone about this drawing that I had in front of me. By this time, we had an updated drawing for Homer. I was no longer looking at the sort of tall Bart in a suit. Homer had gotten a little more refined. We were talking about the voices. He was throwing all these voices at me. He was very generous in that way for me being a stranger and us just working over the phone. He didn't have a fax machine. I remember this. There was no way he had to receive this drawing of Homer. So I'm trying to describe it to him. So I'm doing my best. And he says, oh, do you mean Walter Matthau? I said, well, let me hear Walter. And he starts doing Walter Matthau, and it's a brilliant Walter Matthau. And I said, yes. And he's got this upper lip that's like half a coconut. It's like huge. And so he starts distending his upper lip and while he's trying to do Walter Matthau, and it was Homer. It just sort of came together that quickly. So he got the part over the phone without even being met in person. Never really found one for Tracey, and it just seemed like Tracey had enough on her plate that no one would mind if I didn't actually push on that. And Gabor Chupo used to make this sucking sound for Maggie, pinching his cheek and doing a kind of liquidy sound with his by pinching his cheek and pulling it in and out. And there we had it. They were so simple. They were 10 seconds long. Each moment was timed to be like a 10-second snippet. So they were super short. And, you know, if you've seen them, they're very crudely drawn. I mean, they really are a little alarming looking. I remember Matt was at my office, and I had Gabor Chupo come over. And they had done this thing where they photocopied onto acetate older drawings of Matt's. So there were some Life in Hell rabbits that had been blown up, various drawings, and they'd started to try painting them on the back, you know, the sort of old school animation way. And most of them were various kind of flesh tones for this family. And then at the end, Gabor pulled out this one in this kind of school bus yellow. And once again, Matt and I looked at each other and said, oh my gosh, we have to. It's so sick. And it was like an immediate yes to the yellow that I think Gabor was nervous about pulling out. I never checked with him later, but I wonder if he was actually contemplating leaving it in his bag and not showing us. But I think he saw that we weren't getting excited about all the rest. That was another turning point, was the realization that they were going to be kind of like Lego brick yellow. There was the very first one was recorded with great fanfare on an expensive soundstage. We had a director that week for that episode of the Tracey Ullman Show, Harvey Miller, I want to say, like an old time TV director guy. And so everybody was frantic that the recording of these shows was going to be some high profile event. We needed to dot every I and make sure we're up to union standards on everything. And so that one was kind of big and strange and awkward. You know, there must have been 10 people sitting there listening to the recording and commenting, and it was weird. It was like whatever the opposite of intimate was. It was like the actors were like 30 feet away, and then fortunately everybody got bored with that whole process. Nobody wanted to do that again. And so we had in the soundstage where we shot the Tracey Ullman Show, we had actually built an audio booth up behind the audience that was maybe 6 feet wide by 20 feet long. They just needed a place to record from where they weren't getting any extraneous sound, any audience sound, anything. So we sort of turned it inside out and made it a place that we could sit and record in because it was private and nobody was using it. So I remember doing some in there. It was all very marginal and sketchy and not very well lit even. I remember being strangely dim in there. And then eventually sound editing was this huge issue. Somebody had to just cut the takes out and string things together and build the piece that we would then give to Klasky Chupo. And that was, again, not budgeted for. And we found on the lot a sound editor, and I can't remember what he was supposed to be working on, but there was just nothing for him to do. And so we were literally borrowing his time to assemble the audio tracks for the Little Simpsons and M.K. Brown shorts.
So we started doing this cartoon, but I didn't know anything about animation. I'm working for people who have very high standards. I need this stuff to really work. How am I going to design this process? Because there's nobody else to do it. How am I going to design this process so I know we're going to deliver something that's going to be of a kind of quality that's going to work for them? And so I came to an idea. I thought, these are going to be 30-second pieces. Matt's a funny guy. He's a newspaper cartoonist. He doesn't know anything about animation. But we write a little script, and that script is funny. And I record the voices, which I knew I could do. And then I cut it like a little radio show with overlapping dialogue, and it's really fast and funny. Then it may not matter what the visuals are because it's going to be funny in and of itself. Each week, Matt and I would sit down at a little IBM PC and type up a little two-page script for each 30-second piece. I would go in and record the voices. I would go edit it, overlapping dialogue, really fast-paced. And then Matt would draw what he thought was a storyboard, which was really a newspaper cartoon, right? We would take them into these animators at Klasky Chupo. They would sit down with us. I would go through it, and I'd say, okay, from here to here, this run of dialogue, you do not open it. You don't change it. How it works, the rhythm of it, the spacing of it, it stays exactly as is. Here and here, where there's a visual joke, you can open it up to tell your joke. But here, you keep it like it is. And so that's what they would do. They would animate to the tracks. And that was it. It was just a little tiny kind of like underground operation within the Tracey Ullman Show. No one thought of those as being important. What was important was the live action stuff. This little animated thing, nobody took it seriously, which is one of the reasons that we were able to make something really great, because no one was paying attention. It was what I always wanted to do, is direct. And this was a kind of directing, so I loved it.
While Paul was finding his calling, the man who had given him the opportunity to find it was reaching his breaking point.
It almost took me leaving, or close to when I left, to learn what associate producers in television actually do. It really is a pretty well-defined job. Through a horrible, perfect storm of my, psychological and emotional damage, plus the things I'm interested in, plus the absolute perversity of Jim Brooks and Richard Sakai as the guys that I like to call not so much good cop, bad cop, but bad cop antichrist, I basically smiled and said yes to everything they threw at me. Whereas my understanding is that in most television show structures, an associate producer is basically managing the paperwork for post-production. In other words, if the sound guy brought the sound effects, did they get logged? Is the music cleared? Who wrote which piece of music? And is all of the paperwork traveling with the show? And did the editors make the deadline? That's it. And somehow I got involved in designing the live show experience, finding the comics that would warm up the crowd, choosing the band that would warm up the show. They asked me to kind of like find the hair and makeup people and the costume designer and director of photography for the show. And it was just like, okay. I thought that was associate producing. And so they found the perfect like guy who can't say no. And, another favorite memorable moment was we're having one of those bad evenings and all the producers are suddenly now in the editing trailer fretting about one of these shows that will not cut together. Nothing's funny. We're all getting bleary eyed. It's getting to be midnight or after or something. And I turn around and I cannot tell you how my heart sank when I realized that Andrea, the production assistant who basically, sat at the desk outside my office and managed my communication life, was sitting there having so much trouble staying awake. I had no idea she was there. I mean, I just literally had been staring at the monitor so long, I had no idea she was still in the room for hours. And I said, Andrea, please forgive me. Are you safe to drive home? Go now. And she says, thank you, and leaves. And Sakai turns to me and said, why did you let her go? And I said, Richard, one of us should be semi-conscious at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. I think there's pretty much zero chance of that now, but maybe she'll be a little fresher than me tomorrow. What was funniest to me about the whole journey was that I had people pull me aside and say, please explain to me how you get to talk to Richard Sakai the way you do. And I had so much trouble explaining it. It's sort of like it came from an early misunderstanding, but then I got used to it. The early misunderstanding was that I thought that Richard was playing the role of the nasty producer. Like, I remember they were pitching. I wish I could remember the specifics. He announced that they were making some change. They were doing something in some different way. Again, because I just kept assuming he was like a more rational, like normal person with his emotions parked in more normal places. And I just turned to him and I said, Richard, I have to tell you, I think that's about the worst idea I have ever heard in my life. And what's funny is that we did have this strange little dynamic where he'd say, what do you mean? I'd say, if you do that, then this person is never going to be motivated to contribute anything of value. It screws up this thing. And then this is going to get all out of whack too. Why don't you just do this instead? He was, okay, all right, you figure it out. You know, and people would come out of those meetings like, what? What did you just do? And I'd say, I have no idea. It's sort of like, it's almost like that Alice in Wonderland thing. If you just take care of the sense, the sounds will take care of themselves. You know, it's just like, if you just take care of the meaning of each of these conversations and try to get hung up on how weird everybody is, you know, maybe we can get something done here. I don't know. I was joking that Brooks was the Antichrist. Part of it is that I had invented a personality for him based on our one early meeting. And the idea that he had the capacity to write characters with startling insight into the human dynamic and the little ways that people hurt each other's feelings. And I was assigning to him a ton of wisdom that I assumed would manifest on the Tracey Ullman Show. And it's unfair for me to have done that because, of course, movies are works of fiction. Once I had given them notice, I did a kind of rare assertive thing and said, you know what, I'm going to insist on an exit interview with Jim. That was a little kind of shocking. And I just said, you know, there's just like a handful of things that I want to try to articulate to you because you're the one who hired me and got me into this. And I just want to say these things because I will just feel crappy about myself if I didn't try. And he said, okay. And I said, one is you've made a profound commitment to a kind of producer personality that is very negative, that is very downbeat or pessimistic, or I guess, let me put it this way, that in replacing me, please know that what you're really replacing is a cheerleader. You need a cheerleader here because Richard gets talking to somebody who's been working, you know, 90-hour weeks, and the next thing he knows, they've quit and they're on their way to their car. And then he's on the phone to me saying, go get them. They're in the parking lot. Go get them. They're trying to quit. Make them stop. And that happened so many times. It's not even funny because Richard had some upside down reflexes that I never understood. In other words, we've all been at places where you suddenly turn around and you realize this one person has been carrying too much of a load and they got the bags under their eyes and they are drooping. And that's the moment where most managers on the planet, even the worst ones, will take the person out to lunch and say, look, I can't do anything about your hours and I can't do anything about your salary, but I need you to know we appreciate you. We see that this is an especially rough patch. We're so grateful that you're doing it and hang in there. Okay. That's most managers. Richard, he sees that demeanor on the hardest working person that week on the show. And he pulls him aside and says, if you don't get your fucking act together, I'm going to fire your ass. He couldn't stop himself. That's his instinct when he sees someone in that kind of psychic pain. He has to go there. And so I was trying to basically synopsize that for Jim. He didn't get any of it. He thought he had just graciously spent time with a Looney Tune. Like I had sat and farted and burped and drooled a little bit. It was one of the least satisfying conversations that maybe I've ever had in my life. It wasn't good. I get to this moment of declaring my departure, you know, and now they want to throw all sorts of relief and money at me. And I can't even hear them. I allowed myself to go past the point of negotiation. And so that actually embarrasses me. That feels very immature. There was an ugly bump in the road. Maybe a year later, I found out that Tracy had been lobbying for my return, which is so sweet. And I mean, I'm not actually even sure what would motivate that. You know, it's not like I had the power to do much that would affect her or impact her life on the show. And so Richard calls me and says, what'll it take to get you back? And I say, Richard, you know, we've been through too much for me to be anything less than completely blunt with you. Agreed? He said, yes. The only thing that would entice me to come back is if I was replacing you. That's literally it. I mean, I don't see that happening, so I don't think there's anything to talk about. He says, no, that's what we want. You know, I'm not gonna do this forever. We wanna train you up. Have you do my job? I said, really? He said, yeah. And like the next day, a lawyer from Fox calls me to start negotiating. And this is how naive I am. I said, oh, did Richard give his notice yet? And then Laurie gets really flustered and hastens the end of the call. Richard calls me back and says, what did you say? And I said what you said. He said, you can't say that. And I say, well, what was I supposed to do again? He says, oh, you have to trust, you know, that's what it's moving toward. I said, oh, no, but that's why I left the first time. I trusted that you guys were going to do all of these other things that were actually verbal and not contractual, and you never did any of them. And he was like, ugh. It was one of the most satisfying / unsatisfying last bumps in the road. And I would like to make myself sound really kind of crafty and smart, but I was actually just stumbling through each of those conversations with barely a clue.
It was around this time that Paul was given the directive to find a new animation title sequence for the Tracey Ullman Show. Just like before, Paul was calling around to animation companies, but this time he found what he wasn't looking for.
Then we had a bunch of things happening, but it just seemed like it was over, and I thought, I just have to take care of my new child, and this is going to be my life. I'm going to be a producer of animation. I was like, okay with it, but I missed writing a lot. I was kind of burning to write something. And in the middle of this one day, I get this phone call. You know, I was like, Rhythm and Hughes. And the phone call was like, hey, this is John, the Paul Germain. I'm over to Grace Comes on. We got a big problem. You know, Tracey Ullman Show. We need a new credit sequence. And he was going on and on. I was like, Paul, calm down. He's like, what? Joe, is that you? And I said, yeah, it's me, Joe. Everything's going to be okay. It's like, what are you doing, man? And it's like, oh, I'm working at Rhythm and Hughes. You are? Oh, I'm at Gracie Films. It's crazy over here. I'm really stressed out. And I was like, calm down. What do you need? Oh, we need a new credit sequence. Oh, we'll take care of it, you know. So we went over there and we pitched a new credit sequence, and they had done the credits with Klasky Szupo. The guys who were my directors were all fans of Klasky Szupo, and they were like, why would you want to change this credit sequence? And I was like, I don't know. So they just did a computerized version of the credit sequence and I was like, guys, this is not going to get us anywhere, you know. I was like, no, but it's so great. I don't want to mess with it. And I was like, I don't think this is good. So we didn't get the job. But it started up this friendship that had kind of disappeared, you know, because Paul was off doing his thing. I was doing my thing.
Joe's exhausted impression of Paul couldn't have been more accurate. Like Townsend, Paul was burning out from the grind at Gracie Films, a burnout that would reach the end of its fuse when The Simpsons became its own television show.
The Simpsons happened because of Jim Brooks's will and his power to make things happen. Fox thought it was a bad idea. They thought it would never succeed. He kind of said, this is what we're doing. And because of who he was, they went along with it. No one had any idea it was going to become what it became, right? Once they decided to go to series, a bunch of more important people jumped onto the process and were turning it into a series. People with a lot of experience in sitcoms, and people like Sam Simon, who was kind of a brilliant guy, kind of came on and were taking it over, and I was getting sidelined.
For his contributions to the shorts, Paul was made a co-producer, which, like associate producer, is a job that even the person doing it isn't quite sure what they do.
You can be the co-producer. Wow, that's great. Here, go get us pens. I thought my role would be a little better than that. So that was at the point that I did a couple of episodes. I was really unhappy and I just kind of left.
While Paul was floundering, The Simpsons proved that animation could once again be for adults. But it wasn't that adults were just hungering for animation of any kind. It was the overall package of the project, from its writing to its visual style. When other broadcast networks tried to capture the success of The Simpsons with their own primetime animated programs, they failed miserably, as they had for most of the medium's history. When launching The Simpsons, Matt Groening said, part of the reason I'm doing this is because I'm so unhappy with what has been done. Animation for TV is about the lowest form of entertainment in existence. There's been an outcry about violence on TV affecting children adversely. What really affects them adversely is bad animation. Since the Flintstones had gone off the air, it had been the dark ages for television animation. The last primetime animated show before The Simpsons was Hanna-Barbera's Joke Book, which lasted a measly 3 episodes. However, once The Simpsons were being developed, other networks didn't want to be lacking in competition. The next fully animated show on a major network was Fish Police from Hanna-Barbera in 1992 on CBS. It was a police department with fish. The fish wore clothes, and it had John Ritter.
If New York is the melting pot, then Fish City can only be described as the bouillabaisse. Trust me, being a good cop in a bad town can be murder.
Six episodes were made, 3 were aired. It finished 77th out of 90 primetime shows that week, and the LA Times noted it was a blow to the future of primetime animation. Other successes would eventually come, but the most immediate success were cartoons for cable. Meanwhile, The Simpsons was on its way to becoming the longest-running animated television show in history, and Paul Germain was on his way out.
I was 30 years old. I just had a kid. You know, I was kind of disillusioned. I had sort of thought, you know, maybe I'll just go and become a teacher. I don't want to do this anymore. Gracie Films was kind of a trial by fire or a sink or swim, you can think of it, kind of place. You learned a lot, but you didn't know you were learning a lot. Mainly, you just felt like you were under pressure, you know, and it was just hard work and people getting angry, and it was just not fun for me. I thought I was going to become a teacher. I mean, I remember that Brooks, when I was leaving, he gave me a teacher's satchel as a gift. You know, I thought I was washed up in the film business. I thought it was over.
He left The Simpsons. The Simpsons. Paul hopped off the speeding money train. But remember, this was the ground floor. This was before The Simpsons were The Simpsons. And yet, regrets still linger.
Oh, I have very mixed feelings of it. I know it was probably the right thing to do at that time, but I felt bitter about it for years. But ultimately, you know, it wasn't my show. It was Matt Groening's show. A friend of mine once said to me, you know, because I remember being kind of bitter about it when it had done so well, and thinking I had really been instrumental in doing the original animation that went on the show. And I really had. But a friend of mine once said to me, you know, you weren't the parent there. You were the midwife. And you need to accept that. And I thought, God, he's right. And once he said that, I kind of stopped feeling the way I had about it. I kind of let it go and said, you know, I was an instrumental part of its, just the inception of it. But after that, what it became as a series, what the characters became and how they went, I really wasn't involved in that. I can't take any credit for it.
Paul was done. However, right before he was about to leave, he was approached by Gabor Chupo. Paul sets the scene like it's a film noir.
And what happened was, I gave 2 weeks' notice, and I was still working on The Simpsons show, you know, finishing up my work there. I remember I was at a sound facility, and things were kind of quiet, and Gabor Chupo came over, and he said, hey, I heard you resign. And I said, yeah, I gave my 2 weeks' notice. And he said, why? And I said, I don't know. I just didn't like the way things were going. I didn't think it was for me. And he said, so you've told them you're leaving? And I said, yeah. And we haven't discussed this before, right? And I said, yeah. And he said, why don't you come work for me? And I said, doing what? And he said, well, I think when The Simpsons takes off, animation is going to go into a new era, and I want to be ready for it, and I want to develop my own shows. And he said, why don't you come do development for me? And I said, oh, I've done development. I don't think it's what I want to do. And he said, look, come over, do it for the summer. You can't start your teaching until fall anyway. Do it for a summer. If you don't like it, you can leave. And I said,
the decision he was about to make would end up being one of the best and worst of his life. And there was a lot to factor in. He knew the dredges of Hollywood. He knew how unhappy he was at The Simpsons. And he knew the feeling of being slighted on credit and being pushed aside from a position of creative input. But he also knew the rush of cultivating an idea from script to screen, the thrill of directing and producing, burning the midnight oil, and the oh-so-important validation from the viewing public. The allure of Hollywood is that it's a place that you're working with Jack Nicholson. The reality of Hollywood is that you're probably getting him a sandwich. But Hollywood's siren song can blind even the most seasoned and wise. And for Paul, after all, it was just for the summer. Just the way Gracie Films had been 6 years earlier. The most important quote in Paul's story is not that he was raised communist, or that he jumped up in a meeting to be part of life in hell. Rather, it was his answer to Gabor's question.
Do it for a summer. If you don't like it, you can leave. And I said, okay.
By the end of the 1980s, Paul and Joe had become realists, practical in their approaches to life. Joe was still a producer at Rhythm & Hughes, working to support his family. And Paul was going to be a teacher, after one summer on Seward Street. They were now in the film business, which they once loved, not for love, but necessity. And so this episode ends on a quote from Langston Hughes. What happens to a dream deferred?